Hello, everybody. My name is Matt Bussey. I'm the Program and Digital Marketing Manager. We hope you guys have been enjoying the films. We hope you guys enjoyed 100 million views. I'm very happy to introduce to you the director and subject of the documentary, Itamar Rose. Hi, Itamar.
Thank you. Subject of the documentary. It's nice. It's nice.
Okay. Yes. Subject, the star of the documentary. I guess, yeah. Is that better? And interviewing Itamar, we actually have Bernadette Wegenstein. She is the director of The Conductor. Now, The Conductor, some of you may have seen, we showed that a few days ago at the Philadelphia Ethical Society. If I'm not mistaken, it's actually coming out to theaters or on demand in January, I think.
Theaters in January. Yeah.
Theaters in January.
On demand in March. Yes.
Awesome. Awesome. So yeah, we're welcome to have you guys. I'm going to let you guys get talking. I'm just going to hide myself and mute myself.
Hold on. I'm going to move my hand back because it looks a little odd in the background.
Okay.
Itamar, what do you have hiding in the back?
I don't know. It's interesting. I'm not... I did a film about YouTube, so I'm supposed to be good with this stuff, like Zoom and like this, but I have no idea,
I understand. So
like the magic is not working at Zoom if you are relying on personal charm or something like that, so it's very hard in Zoom.
No, I understand. I mean, I'm also a person who, you know, loves people. And so I love to see them in actuality and not just, but I will do my best to get the best out of you. And I know it's late in Israel, so I'm really sorry. So you have to not only be on Zoom, but also in the middle of the night. But I wanted to tell you that I absolutely love your film. I think it's really one of the most important films made about not just YouTube, but new media culture and, you know, like culture and the like. I told you already, I want it to be bought by our university. I want every student really to see it. I think we'll get there, you know, but I want to talk to you now about, you know, I guess Matt was saying, you know, you're the subject of the documentary and you're not, because you're taking us through the world of this YouTube environment. But what do you, in your own words, what is the subject of this documentary?
When I started working on it, I had no idea. And usually when I'm doing stuff, I started from short satirical videos, mostly in the art scene. Mm-hmm. And I like comparing myself a little bit like to South Park, as if it's like a crazy world of South Park, but they know what they want to say from the first moment. And in my first feature film, I didn't know. I got money very easily from Israel, like funds and channel. And I started my journey really from a fascination of YouTube and that I wanted to understand something about a world that I don't understand, and about the crisis of the old media, trying to adjust to this new world and especially to this new language, like new cinematic language and a new way of telling a story without not a classical story like Aristo or something like that. Because all the times when I pitched on the movie before, so I said that like everything from the most... from a commercial to the most serious novel, everything was on the same structure. And then came YouTube and TikTok. And so we were like all the old people, like not the old people, but the old old school people that were in charge of the content in the world didn't know how to work with this, didn't know what they're seeing, what is it. And So this was the starting point. And it's the, and what I understood about this world, like in the movie, it was a process. So in some way, in the editing, I didn't jump to the conclusion. I all my journey was there, like it was in the real world. I really came with a kind of naivety and fascination. I think all the world is understanding something about the structure of the
of this medium
of this medium, and no, about the forces behind, and about how and it's a film about how the capitalist forces, how the capitalism, and I'm a capitalist, I'm not, I'm coming from inside, I'm not coming from outside, but how, when it seems magic, how fast they close this, this wild west of content, how fast they're adjusting, and I don't,
I understand what you're saying. Yeah, no, it's great. You know, and honestly, I understand, you know, we are all, English is not my native language, although I've been living here and I've taken a lot of the classes with your language tutor. No, not really, but living in America is like taking this class every day, because the language is so present. Yeah. So let's say, we're, you know, it's totally fine if you don't find the right words. But one question maybe that's very simple, you know, as a filmmaker myself, when you think about YouTube or this world, as you say, this new media environment that you dove in, what kind of emotions did you go in there with? You know, were you critical or were you fascinated and naive, as you say, but how naive are you, you know, like what are the feelings that you had going in there?
I think I was really inside and outside all the time, that I'm not like a board style that is completely outside, that it's all like just a way to laugh on, and I'm not really someone that want to be a YouTube star, but there is a part of me that really want to be a star. For real, and I think it can make for some of the audience antagonism to the film, that because it's going on the and this is what I like at the film, and I thought about it, like we had a lot of rough cuts, and I like that in the end it's without a decision of becoming like completely critical, like laughing on the YouTube world or on the young people there. And I think the audience can feel, you know, to be ambivalent to me as a character and my intentions. And I think in some, and I like this position because I think most of the people are attracted, but afraid, and most of them are in this position that they know that they have to adjust, that they cannot ignore it and just laugh on it, that it's part of the world. So
you wanted to sort of give the viewer this ambivalence that you yourself have about.
I don't like that the audience feel secure too much.
Yeah.
I didn't want them to feel you're completely safe. I'm exactly, we are now the smart guy from the university that is laughing on the young people in YouTube. No, I wanted to, that they will feel in some places unsecure about me, about their position as viewers. If I'm humiliating my wife or my child, if it's really for getting views or for telling or to use it as a point, as a satirical point. So I think it's more interesting when morally the position, the moral position is not completely settled. It's more interesting for me. Like, I can be really afraid when people see the movie, you know, they can feel really angry on me, they can feel so...
So what have the reactions been to your movie? Like, for instance, when somebody would be angry about it, what, why?
In Israel, like, the young people are very now conservative and about the part with my son and
Hitler,
dressed like Hitler, so they're angry, less about humiliating my wife with the
animal.
Yeah, with the animal in Israel, the Holocaust is more. And in some of the gags, like, there is points that it's hard for some of the people, and some of the funny stuff that we took some out that were too much.
Tell me about those.
There was I have like the blog. Someone didn't like do like a blog with the about Mabuto from Africa that I'm laughing at. So I had another blog that I'm completely naked, as if I did a surgery of becoming a girl. And I think it was just not very aesthetic, like, because I'm very hairy, you can see. So it was distracting, not in a good way. Maybe if I were younger and more shaved or something like that, it would work, but it was not a very pleasant. But it doesn't matter. But I liked it because it was humiliating myself. And we had another more stuff that there were. The most, I had something that that in the end, in the last rough cut we put inside, and the German laughed but told me to put it out, that I was peeing in... I did something as if I'm like peeing in my
pants.
In my pants, yeah. Really peeing. And it was like a satirical sketch, laughing on like the ALS, all the challenges of helping the world, that, you know, with the ice bucket and like this. So it was something, trying to laugh on this, but it was. It's like for advanced audience. If you want, I will send it to you. But what was interesting, that I put it in YouTube few months ago, like, and then it started, people started in the gays community. I don't know if in English you can say gay community.
You can say LGBTQ.
No, but I think it's more the gays.
Oh, it's more the gays. The LGBT. Yeah, you can say that. Yeah, you can say
because
that.
Because I saw it. I didn't see any lesbian that shared my video, but but I saw a lot of gays that
they liked it. Yeah.
Yeah, they liked more this hairy, not the very bear. My style. Maybe.
Yes. Well, speaking of about the bear man, the hairy man, let me ask you about Yosemite Bear.
Yeah.
And because there, I have to say, I did feel in the scene that you were truly fascinated with him. And of course, it was also from my perspective, you know, like the way that I, of course, frame everything through my own values and interpretation. You know, I was personally not taken by Yosemite Bear, but I was taken by you being taken by him. And so what is fascinating to you about this man and about his YouTube video of the rainbow, double rainbow?
Yeah, in some way is the first one. It's a lot of time when someone is talking with me, it's making me thinking for the first time about, like, it's helping, like, it's the first time I'm thinking about it, that I think he invented in that moment, like kids react, or videos of that you see people react to another videos, like, and it wasn't to a video, but it was, it was for a fascination from nature, and I think it's like a magical, it's like a magical moment, because it's about how we are far away from nature, and only through someone else we can connect, like his fascination or his, like we are already numbed, and we cannot, we lost our sensitivity. So maybe someone that is taking, it's like taking the drug that he's taking with him, because mm-hmm. I think it's connected maybe to drugs at that moment. Like a total fascination from nature. And I think he invented the genre without even thinking about it, about people reacting and like seeing the audience and not seeing the object. Like it's not a video of the double rainbow, it's you see the double rainbow, but all the video is, it's about his sound.
Yeah, his excitement.
And you don't see, and you don't see him. It's mm-hmm. just the sound that is, so this is the reason I was so fascinated. And he's a very charismatic and, you know, that he died like a year ago. And it's can like, is someone that is a very unique person. It's not like, I want to say that it's not like I really liked him. I was like fascinated by him, but it's not like I was in love like in that person, because he's not a very nice person.
Why? How is he? Or how was
how he? Was?
Yeah.
Is like greater than I think he has like a, you know, like he's like a cult leader. And I didn't show that, like if I had a series, like a TV series for 100 million views, I would do a chapter on him. Because it's a lot of layers, very strange layers, that he have a lot of girls from all over the world that are coming to work there. For him, very, very strange stuff. And he was a truck driver and a fighter in the MMA, like, you know, like WWF, a very strange person. But
I see. So maybe this is already like a nice bridge in a way to a topic that, of course, you satirically perform with your wife. I really loved that scene, because for me, you know, I'm a feminist filmmaker, but I think you need to see things, you know, and I think that's what satire and entertainment is for. So I absolutely have, you know, I liked this scene. But in general, I think, if you talk about Yosemite Bear as being sort of a cult leader with lots of young girls in his office, and I think there's so much sexism in this world, in this YouTube world, right? And I think you really revealed it with some of your interventions, and including the one with your wife. And so do you care about women? I mean, is that what you want? Like, for me, you know, I loved it because I felt somebody needs to go there and needs to dare to go there, because it's an uncomfortable place. And so why do you go there? You know, what are you trying to show?
In a very strange way, this sketch with my wife, this is the first thing I shot in for the movie. Mm-hmm. Even before I got money, the first shekel or dollar from... And I put it in YouTube. Sometime I thought it's like that you can do hide, but it was there. And then it just, after I finished the movie, but before it was out there, it really go by itself. And now it's like 11 million views or something like that, without even one time do share or something like that, nothing. And it's really only shows exactly what you say. It's not about what people really likes. It's about what YouTube, the way YouTube works, because it's not a good, it's even not a sexy video, but it's going on the algorithm of YouTube with the name of the original, like very close to the original, with a woman, with an animal. And this is enough.
Yeah.
All what I did in all my life as a creator, if I combine everything, including the people that saw 100 million views, it's not near for that moment without anything inside. Like, so just... And it's not like I did, it's not satire about how people are horny and hate women and like this. It's about how YouTube.
Yeah, absolutely.
I don't believe there is one person that really chose to saw this video because he liked it. I think, and I saw in the statistic, YouTube just suggested it.
Yeah.
With another videos. Like, there is no real virality in this video. So the 11 million views is just because YouTube is selling this perversion.
Yes, absolutely. I mean, I think that's why I'm serious. I've already talked to my students about this, you know, and just quoting it, because I think to me, it's one of the best criticisms that anybody has ever made, using the algorithm itself and using YouTube itself to reveal the stupidity and the banality of misogyny, because it's just like it's just like a formula. And I think that's what's so brilliant about it. And, you know, because it's so stupid, it's completely. And I do think that, you know, I want to congratulate you on this, because you didn't go in there to show me or any other people your feminist interpretation. You know, we are reading it for ourselves in from this actionism. And I think it's brave, and I think it's smart and funny too. So it's all of these things. And I think therefore, you know, I really love it. Now, let's talk a little bit about the children. You know, I have three children myself, and I didn't have a child crisis this morning because my children are probably older than yours. But anyway, you know, I think the vulnerability of the David video after his anesthesia, I didn't know about this video, for instance. And so then when I talked to people about it, I said, I saw this film. And then some people said, no, we know the genre of the anesthesia videos. And you showed some of those kids, you know, the one child who says YouTube, YouTube before he falls asleep. I mean, it really affected me as a mother, I think. So what is your position on it? Are you also fascinated by this, and or are you also appalled by it? or what, why did you include children in your film?
First of all, I have small children, so, and I think this is what is most interesting me in the world now. It's like, if you ask me what is my favorite favorite book, I will say, you know, Dogman of Dav Filkey. So yeah. Like, this is the, like, all my world now is child world. And I was interested, first of all, the story of David, like I said, that Yosemite, I didn't really like him. I was fascinated by him. So in David family, it really, I felt like if I had a series, I will do like two chapters only on David family, because it was something with the father that it's about this magic moment that in the first stages of YouTube, that you feel that you got something, but it's not really yours. And from that moment, they are like searching, not David. David is just like, he's not a victim, maybe he's a victim, but the father feels that he finds the gold or something really special, and he's trying to, all his life now, to find the way, the formula to that moment again. And he's trying all the time to do new sketches and to use, he thought maybe it's the car, so he did like talks in the car. He thought maybe it's David, so he did stuff with David. He thought maybe it's the anesthesia, so he took himself, he shot himself while he's going to the dentist and taking drugs. So, and in some way, you're talking about the other children that tried to do the same as David, but David tried to do the same like David and didn't succeed too. Like, he's part of the story. He's exactly like the other children. He made it and he did some money of it, but his only moment was when he was like 7 years old, and from...
Yeah,
and he's just a regular kid, like nice kid, and so. But what is interesting with this sequence of all the other children is the same, like with the woman with the goat, how YouTube is using how the algorithm is shaping the way we will. We will raise our children. And you can see from like how it's even without like me doing a deep research about algorithms, how they're educating everybody to follow the algorithm. So people, even without really thinking about it deeply, so they're giving the right names, doing the right stuff in order to go on the algorithm. And the children, the story of the children is not different. It's different from times before, like people that was sending the children to TV shows, because the real difference that now everybody can take part on this. It's not like only the super achiever father or mother that is pushing the child, like, because every moment can be that moment, so we're all in this game. It's like reminding me, like, a long time ago, 20 years ago, everybody were laughing on Japanese people taking pictures with expensive cameras, instead of living, like, in vacation, instead of enjoying the vacation, they were all the time taking pictures. But now everybody's doing it all the time. So, so like the technology is changing us deeply. It's interesting.
Very interesting. And, you know, I'm just writing down some notes here. I think what you said is really so pertinent, that, you know, it's the parents who are sending the children out to sell something that they're dreaming of. And I think this magical meme that came of David, it's also in German, there's this word, it says Eintagsfliege. It means like a fly for the day, you know, and it's it was this moment, this meme that was just on that one day, but it really, you know, changed so many other children's and parents' attitudes, you know, toward toward what is permissive and how they can, you know, go about selling and uploading their children. But I don't want to talk too much. So let me ask you the next question. Nazim, I mean, Nazim, really, Itamar, this really got to me. I mean, I got very obsessed with her. And after I watched your film, I was actually in Denver at the film festival. My producer came in and she's like, what are you doing? And I was like watching all of Nazim's videos that I could find. You know, she said, what is this?
She's good.
Yeah, she's amazing.
Yeah, she's amazing.
And no. And so I think I just want to tell you, I was so shocked by that story, because when this happened here in some Santa Bruno, whatever it's called, you know, I heard about it, but it was so downplayed. I mean, Google really took it down, so that, you know, we hear about so many shootings. This one, we didn't hear much about. And I don't know, I think it's a tragic story that says so much, but I don't want to speak for you. I want you, tell me, what do you feel about Nazim, and why is she in the film at the end, at such a dramatical moment too, of your film?
Like, first of all, it happened in the end. Like, maybe if Nazim's story would happen when I was in the middle of the movie, maybe it would start with Nazim. In some, I had one version that I wanted to start with Nazim. I did a version for the TV in Israel of three chapters that I'm starting with Nazim and then coming back, because it's I think it's an unbelievable story about a very interesting way to suppress someone on a story, like making fun of him instead of like in some way. First of all, it's what was interesting, it's not only how Google took it down. I don't want them to sue me, because it's I need to start with the smaller companies that will sue me before I will handle Google. But it was interesting, and I think it's also about America and about the culture of small and left, and how cliches of, like, if it was a white male from the South that is going to Google and shooting, so it was a huge story that everybody in the world will know about, how some right wing from QAnon is doing a shooting and trying to shooting the place of freedom of speech. But this, and Nassim, it's the first time that someone from the left is doing a violent act, even almost like a bomb, how you say, like he's doing an act that all the time only the right wing did. And it's the first time that someone is doing something that is pointing a finger to these companies as suppressors of free speech, of free speech and freedom. And so someone committed suicide, mm-hmm. And went and shot people
as in a order to, yeah, it was almost like a performance
Yeah.
You know, like an act of, I mean, there were these performance artists in the 60s, you know, that would, for instance, there was one in Austria called Rudolf Schwarzkogler, and he just shot himself in the arm, and that was his performance. And I think I read it, you know, I read her, she used her own body as a performance piece to make us aware of something. And what makes me so sad is that everybody, she was taken down so quickly that I wasn't able to really mourn what she was talking about. Anyway,
But I'm saying, what's interesting, it's like a suicide bomber in Israel.
Yes.
So the Palestinians started to be suicide bombers in order, not in order to kill five people. It was in order to bring the question of the occupation, yes or no, to the table, that people yes. will notice and they will speak about it.
Yes.
But that it will not be suppressed and that it will be part of the talk. Mm-hmm. And when she did it, I'm sure the last thing she saw that nobody will talk about it.
Yeah.
Maybe she thought people will hate her. People will say, people will love her. People will say, but the fact that nobody talked about it, I think it's so interesting how it's worked. That
interesting.
Like, you know, someone shot YouTube workers and no YouTube people in the news to tell about it.
Exactly. Exactly. It is really, it's eerie and uncanny, the story itself. And like all of the stories that you hit in your film, you know, they say everything in their own, you know, like, so because the time is running out, I have, I mean, The one scene that was more, as you said before, like more of a Sacha Baron Cohen, where you are clearly a, you know, an alien in the room, was this room, you know, with this the conference about how all this is so good for media literacy, and how you exposed somebody who was clearly bought out by the industry, and I think it's an important scene. Because it exposes that. Not that I was surprised, but was it uncomfortable for you to be thrown out from this conference, or do you not care? I mean, what do you feel as a, you know, as a satirical performer and activist in a way in such a moment? I mean, does it embarrass you or?
I was a little bit embarrassed after, because I thought maybe I embarrassed her, like as a professor, a doctor, and I wasn't sure, but I wasn't embarrassed for myself. In some way, I believe that I want to finish everything in bed. Like, how will I know that I did the best I can? If I'm going to a point that I feel not comfortable with myself. Mm-hmm. So while shooting, what editing is something else. In editing, it needs to be in a place that the audience will be not certain. But while shooting, I need to be in a place that, I'm more hardcore than the regular people. And so I'm trying to go to the, like to finish the day, not in a good mood. Like I want to embarrass my, the crew of the film.
Mm-hmm.
Like if I'm coming back and the photographer is shaking, so I went to the edge. That he will say, why we did it? And I will say, because we went to do something that will be interesting that I wasn't expected to, that I don't know how we'll feel to and how people will react. And in the worst case, it will not be part of the film. Like, but shooting, you can shoot everything. So, but this is my character. I don't think it's, if I was in a school for a film, I'm not sure. I will say people to do it because I believe that this is part of art to go, that it will be interesting for you not to know what will, how the day will be.
And this is my last question. So when you say you like to go to the edge, right? And to push things to this extreme. So what is at the edge in your opinion? You know, what do you find there?
It's a very good question. It's something that I need to, it's interesting. It's like going out from my comfort zone and have doubts about myself but I need to think about it. It's a very interesting question. It's I think because I'm married already 15 years and so I'm trying to find interesting stuff to do when I'm not a person that will have roman, how you say, a love story from outside, because I'm too afraid my wife will catch it. And so I'm trying to find interesting moments while I'm shooting.
I understand.
Okay.
No, but I think it's part of your method clearly as an artist, right? And so I don't blame you that you as the artist don't know how to, what you're looking for, because you're just doing it. And that's good enough for us as an audience to then see your film. Okay, so I think, is there something that you wanted to share that I haven't asked? You know, there's always the question, what are you doing next? I don't know if you want to share that.
I have something for the Jewish audience, because we are in a Jewish festival, yeah?
Yes.
It's okay now to have like a Jewish...
Absolutely.
Only for Jewish festival. It's like in the... No, I'm joking. What I want to say, that I have an idea. I say idea, you need to say idea, no? Idea is the idea that...
So I
think my new project is... searching for a new place for the Israeli people, like continue Herzl, coming back to Altneuland. I thought it would be called Altneuland 2.0. That I'm saying the story of Israel didn't succeed, we tried. Let's go back to all the plans and the countries that he searched for. And that I will go to his shoes, have a beard, and go to meet leaders all over the world and people all over the world to trying to find the place for the not religious people in Israel to move or something like that. Like, because I think it's the best option for peace in the Middle East. Everybody is talking about bringing money to the Palestinian instead of coming back, zchut ha-shiva, coming back to the lands. And I'm saying, give us the money and we will leave. So I thought about talking with Trump. Now it's not Trump, it's Biden. About maybe Nevada, place for us, something
maybe
like
the
that.
Space.
The space?
Other space.
No, but Jewish people need big cities next to them. So it's, we need a place
on earth
with coffees, buildings, and not land people, I think.
I agree. So well, I wish everybody could.
What? Yeah. What to say?
I said I wish we could all go back to Vienna, to a Vienna, you know, that was pre 1933, and maybe.
I think the Jewish people, and this is part of the film, like half of them continue the story of Vienna, Berlin, and Warsaw, just in New York, Los Angeles, Miami, and some of them in Philadelphia, like it. And I think the Jewish people in the US continued the way of the Jewish people, being in the major cities. But somehow they let the Israeli version becoming the story of the Jewish and not half of the story. Because if you need to do kind of objective book or film about the history of the Jewish people, it's supposed to be that Woody Allen is not less than Moshe Dayan or Yitzhak Rabin. Like, and it's not Woody Allen, I'm sorry, I forgot.
Woody Allen is not a good name.
It's not a good, I forgot,
No, but I know what you mean, yes, of course. Yeah.
Well, like Jerry Seinfeld.
Yes, that's fine.
That's fine. For now.
For now. I don't think it actually is. He's fine. I forget there's so many men that are doing, I don't know. Let's not even go there. But, you know, I think that would be a great film on the search for this land. And I hope you can make it. And you have the right audience here to screen this film for and to engage in your future work. And I also wanted to say, I think I'm coming to Tel Aviv. We're invited in March, and hopefully I'll be able to meet you. And
we must meet and maybe do something together, because so you are German in your region?
Austrian.
Mm-hmm. I don't know why, but I have the best communication with German, Austrian people, from all the people in the world. I think even the language, I think like Israeli can, and German people, it's the same hard accent in English, and somehow the communication is the best.
We have a lot in common in terms of the, I mean, obviously it's a very different language, but yeah, how it sounds. And the Austrian German is sort of a softer version of the German.
So we need to meet.
Yeah, we definitely need to meet. So I'm very decided. And so I think at this point, Matt is going to come back, I think.
Thank you both so much for joining us. 100 million views. If you're watching this, you can watch it. It's available to stream November 14th to the 20th. And yeah, thank you both for a wonderful conversation. And
Matt, thank you. You're Jewish?
I am Jewish, yes.
Ah, okay. I was concerned that someone joined the party without. I thought maybe because you are working, so it's okay. But
it's all good.
I love it.
Like getting paid, we don't care to pay some people from outside. But it's okay.
But you know, Itamar, I think when I moved to the United States, and this is 20 years ago, I was also surprised. There are so many groups, you know, the Jewish Film Festival or then the feminists and the women's, and it's a very American thing. But I came to really love that, because I think it makes transparent the dedication and even the political orientation. Like if I play at a feminist film festival, it's a different thing as a normal festival, but at least I know who the players are. And it's the same with the Jewish film festivals, and they have really supported the arts so much. So
I think it's fantastic that Jewish people are doing stuff for themselves.
I think so too. I think it's really, and it is, you know, they have a real network of so many festivals.
I want to be part of the network, so we'll talk about
it. Yes, Good.
Your next movie, both of your next movies, yes, submit them to us. Yes.
I mean, Itamar's will be crazy. Yes. About finding the place for these really people.
We cannot wait. Thank you guys so much.
Thank you.
Bye bye.
Good night. Bye bye. Thank you.
Bye bye.